Catastrophic Audio. A movie in your mind.
Graphic Audio presents Rylee Adamson, Book 5, Blind Salvage, by Shannon Mayer. Narrated by Nora Achrati and Chris Genebach, and performed by a full cast. I hated saying goodbye almost as much as I hated Monday mornings. This day had both of those brilliant things mashed together.
Rylee, you don't have to leave. You know that, right?
Will tried to capture my eyes with his. I avoided his seeking gaze and instead looked out across the pond, reliving recent memories as I stared. I could feel again the fear and adrenaline as the beast ran me down, the crush of Eve's talons as she snatched me from his grasp midair. The specter of death had hovered close lately. I closed my eyes, and memories far worse assaulted me. Birgette's death rocketed through me, and then the shock with her apparent rebirth as a vampire, her eyes pleading with me to side with her, to help her become the Empress in truth, so that she would have control of the vampire nation. She'd forced me to make a decision between the family I dreamed of and the family who'd stood by me through thick and thin, and I'd chosen to turn my back on her. I'd left her behind. No, I have to go. This isn't my home, and I don't belong here. I looked around me. My bag of weapons was at my feet, full of all sorts of goodies. Alex splashed at the edge of the pond near Deanna and Pamela. We were as ready to go as we ever would be. Deanna hugged Pamela. While she had petitioned me to let Pamela stay with her and train to become a druid, the young witch had chosen to come with me. Unlike her predecessor, Deanna had let it go at that. Her predecessor, though, I would have gladly removed Daniels' stupid head from the rest of her, but this time around, that hadn't been my job, nor had I been given the chance. Even before we made it back from Venice, Daniels had gone missing, and Deanna was back in charge of the druids. I had to give it to the beast. He didn't waste any time making good on his word to clean house with Daniels. Will surprised me, pulling me out of my thoughts as he tugged me into his arms.
You will always have a place here, Rylee. I need you to know that. No matter what comes, you would be safe here with me.
I felt the overtones of what he wanted, of what I couldn't reciprocate. Maybe if Liam hadn't come back to me, this moment would be a different story. But Liam had come back. Besides, if Will thought he could keep me safe in a world where death and disaster were my constant companions, he didn't know me as well as he thought he did. Will let me go. Kinda. He still hung on to my forearms as he glared over at Liam. I jerked my arms out of Will's hands, but it didn't help. The testosterone and tension in the air grew heavy, broken up only by sheer luck. Alex bolted in between us, slamming into me and then Will like a freaking ping-pong game gone awry.
Home, home, home! Ha ha!
His timing was perfect. In the 2 days since Liam had been back, this was the third time the two alpha shifters had started to lock horns, and it was the third time Alex had interrupted them, essentially keeping them from each other's throats. Smiling, I reached down and scratched him behind the ears. Oh, Alex, you are the best.
Alex knows that.
I stepped away from Will, putting Liam between us, and headed to the car, acting like nothing had happened. A part of me wished Eve was still here, that I could hop on her back and fly the hell away from all of this. But Eve had already left, choosing to hopscotch across Iceland and down the east coast of Canada before banking to the west to North Dakota. The trip home would take her a few days, maybe a week.
Enough! She isn't yours, and she isn't staying here. Let it go, Cat, before this gets ugly.
I turned around to see Liam lift his hand, his light golden eyes narrowing. Wow. I swallowed hard, a part of me bucking under his assertion that I was his, as in belonging to him, as in not my own person. I opened my mouth, and then shut it. Maybe I'd matured. probably not, but whatever the case, I let that bucking part of me settle down, calmed it with the simple truth. Liam was right, but it went both ways. I was his, and he was mine through and through. Will needed to understand that. Pamela joined us, her face clearly showing her confusion as she glanced from Will to me to Liam.
What's wrong?
Nothing. Say goodbye to Will, we're leaving. I pointed at him, and she shyly stepped close to him to give him a hug, her face pinking up, lashes lowered over her bright blue eyes. Will spoke to Pamela, but his eyes never left mine, the intensity in them undeniable.
Stay clear of wolves. They will pull you apart.
Damn it, he was going to push this with every second we had left here. We needed to leave now. I flicked a hand beckoning to Alex, who scampered by my side.
Boss is mad.
Yeah, but he'll chill out once we get home. A quiver ran along my shoulders, a solid feeling of being watched rolling through me. I turned to see Jack standing in the doorway, watching us leave. He hadn't really spoken to me since Liam had shifted back and Millie had stolen the Violet Book of Prophecies. He didn't come down to see us off or even wave goodbye. Not that I cared, at least that's what I told myself. The old bastard had lied and manipulated me with the best of them, but a part of me felt sorry for him, and I fought the urge to go and tell him he could come with us, that he didn't have to die alone. But in that, Jack was right. I had to start putting my foot down. No more charity cases, no more wards to take care of. I had enough trouble keeping those I cared about alive as it was. I turned my head at the sound of a car pulling up. Our ride was already here. Who the hell was coming now? A black, sleek sedan rolled to a stop, blocking off the driveway. Liam's former boss, and my one-time boss, Agent Valley, pulled his short, stubby body out of the car with some effort.
Adamson, why is it that I had to learn through the rumor mill that you'd found Agent O'Shea?
Oh, sorry, my secretary must have lost that memo. Alex, why didn't you tell Agent Valley we'd found Liam?
Alex did an exaggerated point at himself.
Rylee said no tells.
Right, that's why.
Liam moved up beside me. He had shaved off the beard, but had left his hair long. Black as the night sky, it brushed the top of his shoulders, very definitely not FBI agent styled. There would be no more short-cropped brush cut for him. I liked it.
Agent O'Shea, good to see you.
Agent Valley held out his hand and Liam took it.
Just Liam now, sir.
What does just Liam now mean exactly?
I'm not coming back to the office. Things have changed.
Frowning, Agent Valley shook his head.
No, I won't accept that. You're one of our best agents, O'Shea. My understanding is you are a werewolf now, is that correct? We can find ways to work around this disability. I have no doubt of that.
Liam stiffened, his whole body seeming to freeze up. I stepped in between them, stuck my face in Agent Valley's.
Take your disability and shove it up your ass, Agent Valley. We're leaving.
Alex and Pamela made their way to the cab without being told and slid into the back seat. I scooped up my bag of weapons and followed them. Liam, though, stood there unmoving. Shit, the last thing I needed was for him to be unsure about this. We'd talked about it already, and Liam had agreed that the FBI put too many stipulations on its agents who worked with the supernatural. They just didn't understand what it took to get a job done, and they weren't willing to bend. Liam reached out and shook Agent Valley's hand.
Thank you, sir, but we'll both pass.
Agent Valley, king of dramatic reveals, waited until Liam was at the taxi, his hand on the door.
Of course, if that's your decision, then I can respect that. But tell me just one thing. What do you know about a demon named Orion?
My back stiffened and I clenched my jaw shut to keep from giving anything away. I turned ever so slightly and caught Liam's eyes as they widened a fraction before he too caught himself.
Nothing, sir.
Agent Valley didn't look convinced.
You're telling me you don't know anything about a demon named Orion? Or some prophecy that goes like this? The heart of the mountains he will prick, and the land will know Orion's fury for being condemned to the seventh veil. He shall cleanse the land with fire for his coming.
Liam shook his head and I mimicked him, as did Pamela and Alex. All together now, kiddos, and maybe Agent Vallee would believe us. How he had this information intrigued me, but it wasn't enough to make me ask. Will and Deanna withdrew. Though they didn't know the particulars, they did know that I'd stuffed the black-skinned demon book into my weapons bag, which happened to speak a great deal about Orion. Not that Jack knew I'd taken it. No, we'd left a dummy book in its place. I shrugged, going for casual. Nope. Not a single thing. I'd been reading the black-skinned demon book of prophecies, and there was nothing good in them. Not all of them were about Orion, but a lot of them were, enough to seriously worry me. Mostly, they were about how he would help the demon nation be reborn to the world, how he would kill the Tracker and defile her corpse in a variety of ways. Not exactly bedtime reading material. Giselle had always told me prophecies were not to be ignored, but honestly, they were all so freaking contradictory, particularly when it came to comparing the demon's prophecies to any other supernaturals, black and white. So how could they both come to pass? That's right, they couldn't. I had to believe that. Giselle's teachings, her words, floated in my head.
Different branches of possibilities. You know that. Don't delude yourself. Either side of a prophecy can come true depending on people's decisions.
Yeah, I did know it. I just didn't want to think about any of the demon prophecies as being even remotely possible. I slid into my seat beside Pamela in the back of the cab and shut the door. Or tried to. Agent Vallee stuck his hand out and caught the door before I could shut it completely.
Adamson, this is serious. The rumors that are flying, they make our little zombie problem from last month look like a picnic on a fine summer's day. We don't even know what the seventh veil is. We need your help.
I shrugged and did my best not to let him see my mind working.
Not my issue. I'm going home. And for the record, I don't know what the seventh veil is either.
That was the truth. Whatever the veil fully encompassed, I didn't know. Liam slid into the passenger seat next to the cabbie. Agent Vallee took his hand off the door.
We think someone is trying to bring Orion through, to our side. With everything I've heard about how very bad this demon is, I would think you wouldn't want that.
How the hell did he know all this? He'd gone from all but begging me to help him and his arcane arts division to now knowing shit about the supernatural that we didn't. The only answer was that he'd found someone to help him, someone who knew the supernatural. Maybe a reader like Giselle, that was my guess. I glared at him.
Find somebody else to do your dirty work. I find kids. I don't go after demons.
Liam gave the cabbie a nod and the driver turned over the key. Nothing. The engine didn't even sputter once. Fuck me sideways, it looked like Monday had struck again. I looked over Pamela's head at Liam.
Ah, too many of us.
He gave a quick nod and then opened the door.
Alex and I will meet you there.
In other words, he would shift and the two boys would run all the way to the point out in the bush where the cabbie would be dropping us off. Pamela slid closer to me.
Will we have to wait for them?
Not likely. They'll probably beat us there, going as the crow flies. Liam and Alex disappeared around the side of the house. Agent Vallee followed them, close on their heels. Shit. Liam would just have to deal with his boss without me. I slammed the door shut and leaned back in my seat. The driver had no problem with the engine this time, and he maneuvered around Agent Valley's black sedan. My gut was rolling. Without a doubt, this news about Orion was bad. Very, very bad. But I was being honest with Agent Vallee. Demons were not my forte. Just look at what had happened when I'd tangled with the last one, a minor demon on the scale of things. I'd almost died, and in the process had nearly caused an apocalyptic winter. I was nobody's hero.
Liam strode toward the back of the house, Alex tight on his heels.
Running, boss?
Yes. He didn't want to get into any sort of discussion with Alex. While Liam liked him well enough, his wolf wanted very badly to remind Alex that he was still a submissive. Not that Alex stepped out of line very often, but there were little things, like Alex beginning to eat before he and Rylee were done, or pissing on the shrubbery around Jack's mansion as if it were his territory.
Liam! We aren't done yet.
Agent Valley's words brought Liam's feet to a standstill. He owed Agent Valley a moment of his time, if nothing else. Even his wolf understood that.
Agent Valley, there isn't anything I can do to help change your mind, so don't bother asking.
Agent Valley caught up to him, out of breath, his face flushed pink even with the cool mist that floated down on them. His former boss didn't smell like he'd been hanging out with humans. There was something else clinging to him, a faint hint of rot.
O'Shea, I don't think anyone could change your mind once you set on a course. Adamson is stubborn as a rock. That's what my mother would say.
Agent Valley walked along beside him.
Then what is it you want?
Alex angled his head so he could stare up at the agent with one big golden eye.
Yeah, what you want with boss?
Valley startled, a shiver visibly running through him.
He never ceases to give me the heebie-jeebies. I'm sorry. No offense, Matt. I'm still getting used to the idea of the supernatural even existing. Never mind going for a walk with one of them.
Liam was one of those supernaturals now. And though it felt as natural to him as breathing, and he wondered how he had existed without knowing the supernatural before, he did understand what Valley was saying. It took some getting used to. Hell, he'd been far more freaked out the first time he'd met Alex.
Agent Valley, I have to go. So if you have something important to share with me, I suggest you do it now.
If you don't want to work for us directly, that's fine. But as a former FBI agent, I'd ask you to keep us informed of the goings-on that you observe.
Liam's eyebrows shot upward.
Goings-on?
He knew where this was headed, and he didn't like it. They were in the backyard now, and Jack watched them from an upper window. The old tracker probably thought that they couldn't see him, but the flutter of the curtains as he stepped up to the window caught Liam's eye.
We need to be kept up to speed on what's happening in the supernatural world. I have only one other contact, and between you and me, that makes me nervous. You're our best bet for additional information, as Rylee seems to be at the center of so much. Hell, she's nearly always in the thick of things. Will you help us?
Rylee would be beyond livid if she found out he was secretly feeding information to Valley and the FBI. As loyal as he was to Rylee, though, he had a loyalty to those he'd once worked for, too. And a part of him recognized that Valley was right. The Arcane Arts Division of the FBI needed help and information badly. He stuck his hand out, and Agent Valley shook it.
Good man. I'll expect you'll have something for us on a regular basis, say once a week?
Liam shook his head.
You'll get what you get, and nothing more. Everything I can send you will be via snail mail. Electronics aren't all that favorable around me anymore.
That will take too long. We'll be behind the eight ball right off the start line.
That's all I can offer.
He waited, knowing Valley would take him up on it. Liam also knew that, in a pinch, the Arcane Arts Division could be useful for Rylee. Might even have information she could use in her salvages. That was how he justified it. How he eased the niggling thoughts that he was making the wrong decision.
Fine, we'll try it.
Maybe it was some perverse pleasure he took in making his old boss uncomfortable, but Liam didn't look away from him as he shifted. The wolf in him clambered up, eager to break free of the bonds of the human flesh that held him. Agent Valley's eyes widened, and his face drained of color.
Oh, mother of God, have mercy.
Wuss.
In the back of the cab, Pamela hummed under her breath, her toes tapping the floor. She was obviously restless, and though my body was still, I wasn't much better. My mind swirled back to my conversation with Doran just before he left for the States, a conversation I hadn't even shared with Liam.
Rylee, I need to speak with you.
Doran had put a hand to my elbow, quickly dropping it when I glared at him. He wasn't cowed by me, but I'd saved his ass by breaking the bond between him and Birgit, and he wasn't likely to forget that. He'd led the way to the rooftop, the night sky clear of clouds for what had to be the first time since I'd been in London.
I think you need to understand what happened with the vampires, how Birgit became what she is. I can give you everything I know, which is a lot in some ways, and not near enough in others.
His green eyes were serious, something Doran didn't do often. There was no teasing light in him, no double entendre to piss me off. Tell me.
You understand that Birgit was initially taken because of her blood, that she was one of those our kind can't resist?
He lifted an eyebrow at me. I nodded.
Yeah, Louisa told me that the first time I visited her.
She was taken to be a gift to the Emperor and the Empress. A blood gift, to secure the favor of Faris's old master. That is why he was sent to steal her away.
I gritted my teeth. I was angry with Ferris, but even angrier with myself that I'd let myself trust him, let myself believe that a vampire could be trusted. He was the one who'd stolen Brigitte away and had set me on the path I'd walked since then. Regardless of who had ordered it, in my mind, this all fell squarely on him.
Are you telling me it wasn't his fault?
Eyes narrowed, I glared at Doran. He shrugged, unperturbed.
Most of us that are fanged do not have the luxury of doing what we want. Depending on who holds the reins of power, we can be used as they see fit.
I could blame Ferris for his lies, that was straightforward. But maybe I couldn't blame him for taking Brigitte. I shook myself and pushed away that thought. No, I'd seen Ferris there, seen the light of hunger in his eyes. He'd been hoping for a taste of her, too.
When they got her back to Venice for the Emperor and the Empress, it was apparent that the Empress was taken with her youthful beauty and sweet disposition.
He shook his head again.
Vampires can't procreate. They can't have children unless they steal them. It was immediate, the bond the Empress had with Brigitte. I knew the Empress. She was my master before Brigitte. It was more than a bond of mother and child. It was almost like the Empress saw future for Brigitte, which wouldn't surprise me, since the Empress was a reader long before she was a vampire. In the end, she chose to keep and raise Brigitte.
His eyes opened and he stared into mine, the air between us chilling.
It would have been better if they'd killed her. If there had been nothing more than a meal in your sister's future.
I clenched my fists so hard my nails dug into the palms of my hands.
Keep going.
They kept her secluded, let her feed off them. That is the start of becoming.
The first memory Ferris had shown me, I'd seen tiny bite marks all over the Empress's body. Now I knew them for what they were, Brigitte's bite marks. Nausea rolled up, hot and acrid as it coated the back of my tongue. I clamped my mouth shut, clenching my teeth until they ached. I waved at Doran to go on, afraid that if I opened my mouth, I'd spew chunks all over the roof.
I cannot tell you the ritual of how a vampire is created, but you will have to trust me that what I'm telling you is the truth, as far as I am able to share it with you.
He unclasped his hands to set them on his hips.
Becoming a vampire. It takes time. There is no instant creation, no one-night blood exchange, as some would have you believe. Brigitte, the Brigitte you knew, became buried under the blood she was taking, under what she was becoming. Glimpses of her showed from time to time, a child full of love and compassion. I had hoped that things would be better with her as a leader. But then, I was there. When Ferris killed her parents.
I blanched, and he lifted a hand to stall me.
They were the only parents she recalled at that point. They'd made sure of it. And she saw Ferris take on her parents. His brothers were killed, but he survived, barely, and finished the job, taking the Empress's head and heart. Brigitte saw it all. She was 14 at the time.
I managed to speak around gut-churning nausea.
That doesn't explain everything. She knows me still. It's not like her memories are all gone.
Doran stepped closer to me.
When the Empress and the Emperor died, they spilled their auras to her, giving her their abilities, their powers, the bonds they held over those that called them master, as well as their memories. She did not lose her own memories, but they are faint. With the past staining them and those older memories coating them. She is a child carrying the power of two ancient vampires and all that they know. She does not have the strength of mind to handle this. Very few would. She is going mad, slowly, but very surely.
And I suppose you want me to do something about it? Kill her and end her reign of madness?
Fuck, everyone thought I could be the supposed demon slayer, or whatever the hell the prophecies were spouting. Why not be a slayer of psychotic vampires, too? But a large part of me wanted to save her, to bring back the little sister I so wanted to believe was buried inside. What if she could be separated from those memories and all that power? Doran dipped his head so that we were cheek to cheek. Intimate, yet I wasn't getting that take-me-baby vibe from him.
No, this is information. Information you need so that if the chance comes, you don't hold back. She is not your sister. What is left of her soul is not gone, but missing. All that is left is what they were. If there is a way to free her, I do not know it.
His breath was cool against my skin as he breathed each word into me.
Tyrants. That's what lives inside her. Mad, power-hungry tyrants who want to rule the world, both the human and the supernatural. That cannot happen.
I closed my eyes, grief spilling up through me. You'd think that after all these years of hurting, of saying goodbye to her over and over again in my head, that this moment would have been easier. It wasn't.
I'm sorry, Rylee. I truly am.
Even with my eyes closed, I could tell we were getting close to our drop-off. The road got rough, bumps and drops jarring me from any semblance of rest. My brain wouldn't let go of what Doran had told me.
Why didn't we just have Will take us? He has a car that would fit us all.
Pamela's voice pulled me out of my reverie. I turned to her, an eyebrow arching up.
Really? You have to ask that?
She blushed. Yeah, she just wanted one more glimpse of Will.
You don't think they'd really fight, do you?
The upside was she didn't know why Will and Liam didn't like each other. I certainly wasn't going to tell her that the man she had a crush on had a bit of a thing for me, so I fudged it.
Alphas can rarely be in the same room together. It's just the way they're hardwired. They will end up fighting if they stay in close proximity. Just one more reason for us to go home.
Will could control himself. It's Liam that can't.
Right. Whatever.
Nothing Will ever did would be bad in her eyes. The cabbie pulled off to the side of the road where we'd asked to be dropped, pretty much in the middle of nowhere. From here, the directions were straightforward. Follow the dirt path to the rundown castle at the end of the road. Easy peasy. As the cab disappeared over a hump in the road, a rustle from the bushes turned us both around.
Tell me you brought clothes.
Liam stood strategically behind a bush so that he didn't flash Pamela. I reached into my bag and tossed him a shirt and pair of jeans, and the last pair of shoes I had in his size. With all his shifting, we were going through clothes like crazy. He dressed and stepped out from around the bush, Alex right behind him. Tongue lolling out, Alex had a big grin on his misshapen face.
Have fun.
Yuppie doody. Boss is good, boss.
With that, we headed out. Liam led, Alex tucked in behind him, then Pamela, and then me. The heavy brush on either side of us would make for a perfect ambush, which was not something I was interested in dealing with. Without a break in my stride, I pulled a sword from my back and adjusted the bag of weapons so I would have an easy swing at anyone, or anything, that might pop out to say hello. Pamela glanced back at me, saw the sword, and lifted her hands to prep a spell. I didn't stop her. The more ready we were, the less likely we were to get our asses tromped by something. Alex trailed behind Liam like a well-trained dog, never once straying out in front of his alpha. Liam's steps slowed, and he turned his head to look into the bushes as we slid down a small slope into a depression in the ground. Along the edges of the path, the trees were bent. Large branches snapped like twigs, and sap ran freely from the wounds. Whatever had caused this damage, it had been recent and on the far end of the big-ass scale.
Something rather large has come this way.
Liam reached out and touched his fingers to the jagged edge of a broken tree. I tightened my grip on my sword and slowly lowered the bag of weapons. I pulled my other sword from my back and rolled it in my hand.
Alex, can you smell what it is?
The werewolf stuck his nose to the ground and moved in an ever-widening circle, finally stopping about 10 feet out in front of us, his eyes round with fear.
Big bugger.
Obviously, he'd picked up on the local lingo.
What kind of big bugger?
There be giants.
Crouching over my bag, I opened it with a yank on the zipper and quickly geared up. I handed out what I couldn't strap onto my body, a short sword for Pamela, and Liam took the crossbow. Finally, I pulled out the burlap-covered black demon book. Cold seeped through it and into my fingers.
I'll take it.
Liam took the book and shoved it under his shirt, tucking it into his belt. The thing gave me the willies, but there was no way we could leave it behind. Pamela's fingers tightened on the handle of the short sword.
Are we going to have to fight a giant?
Hopefully not. They aren't real bright and love to be destructive. They would make Blaz look neat and tidy. There was a twinge in the back of my head as Blaz, even as far away as he was, perked up as I said his name. I ignored him. Pamela swallowed hard. Liam stared around us, touching the broken branches closest to him.
Why didn't we feel the giant walking?
I read that they move on the other side of the veil, that only when they move on this side of the veil can they be felt moving around. And then the humans think it's just thunder.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.